think we should give the children of Prenton and Glenavon the sports field back to them. Not back to them, but for them to use it. I mean, I think they are willing to buy the facility and then obviously use it. And it's safe and it's secure, the field. It's not like in the middle of a park somewhere. They're going to be surrounded, so they're going to be safe there and they're going to be secure in this field. And my refusal is...
Sorry, through you, Chair. Lots been hung on this email. We did speak to the club. And on page 19 in your report, the junior football club, Glenavon junior football club, told us that they used the site previously, but they'd outgrown the site. The club had become too big to use the facilities there. They then suggest in their email that was sent to the planning department that although they're now using larger sites elsewhere in the club, they've outgrown those. So if they've outgrown Glenavon and now they've outgrown much larger facilities, I'm struggling to understand how they can now say they want to go to small facilities. So, I'm going to miss your song.
Okay, can I just move my refusal anyway, Chair? There is insufficient evidence has been submitted to demonstrate that the playing fields are surplus to requirements or that the loss of the playing field resulting from a proposed development would be replaced by equivalent or better provision in terms of quantity and quality in a suitable location. In the absence of these details, the Council is not satisfied that there would be no conflict with national planning policies and under the development proposed is therefore contrary to policies RE5 and RE6 of the Wirral Unitary Development Plan. Thank you, Chair. Second.
Thanks, Denise. Do you have a second?
I'll second.
Thanks, Jeff. Okay. Dave?
I did say before that I couldn't find a reason that I was refusing or dealing with this as well. Denise has to say. Can I point out again, condition number 11 on the new report before she goes any further?
I've already
moved
it, Dave. Dave, we have obviously had
that's fine.
So all those in favour of refusal?
CH20, which deals with developments affecting the setting of conservation areas and specific specifically the Bromborough Village Conservation Area. The site layout has been amended to take account of interface distances within the site and also having regards to the relationship of the proposed levels with trees along the boundary of the site. The design of the proposed houses picks up on elements from surrounding properties, including steeply pitched roofs, traditional window design and chimneys. The palette of materials proposed also reflects existing housing within the site's proximity. The development has also had regards to heritage and historic environment. The orientation of those properties closest to Mark Rake have their gables facing the highway, replicating the relationship of the Rectory and Stanhope House. It is not considered that the proposals would have any detrimental impact on the setting or character of the adjacent conservation area. A number of conditions are proposed that would protect retained trees on and adjacent to the site, together with conditions recognising the archaeological importance of the site and the potential for archaeological findings. A construction management plan is also conditioned for approval. The proposals are considered to be in keeping with policy HS4 for new development and new housing development and are recommended for approval. There is a qualifying condition of objection.
Thank you, Matthew.
Would
the judicial lights come forward to speak on this?
Just turn on the microphone to be welcome
though. Okay, state your name, address, and
how to
file
the minutes. Yes, I'm Ken Thomas, by the way, as well, Mark Rake. I've been a resident of Mark Rake for 24 years, and it's directly opposite the land in locally with Erection Gardens. Having carefully studied all the details of the application and the planning committee agenda, I'd like to propose this development on planning grounds, and therefore stand by my objection to the member of the second local community. The site is totally unsuitable for the proposal. A few years ago.
Excuse me, could I just ask you to speak closer into the microphone? That's fine, we're struggling to hear you.
Sorry.
Thank you. We'll start 5 minutes again.
The site is totally unsuitable for the proposal. A few years ago, a witness collapsed apart in the sandstone wall facing my house. The rain soaked ground simply flowed across the pavement onto Mark Rake. On more frequent basis, I've seen Mark Rake flood to pavement height. Therefore, the hard surface is envisaged for this development and the answer to these problems. Any new buildings and infill developments to this site, probability of garden sheds, satellite dishes, 30 buildings, 20 parking spaces, detrimental to the character, appearance and historic integrity of the adjoining conservation area. Bromborough Village Conservation Area Appraisal and Management Plan 2000 recommends, quote, the rectory and its grounds form an important buffer zone between the churchyard and residential developments along Mark River. Along the wall bordering the rectory garden lies along a historic field boundary and contributes positively to the character conservation area. It also recommends consideration should be given to extending the conservation area boundary where feasible to include these additional areas as they are of historic importance in the development of the village. The protection afforded by inclusion will help preserve or enhance the character of 16 buildings and spaces within the conservation area. It is an irreplaceable, much valued green oasis in already heavily urban industrial and retail landscape. With its immediate proximity to the Saxon church site, the churchyard, the Bromborough Village Conservation Area, the proposed development will have a negative impact on its atmosphere and tranquility, as well as restricting views from within the conservation area. On obtaining 86 signatures on the petition, all of which are neighbours moving from Mark Rake and in and around the conservation area, all concerned over the visual impact of development felt have a negative effect on the development of the character of the neighbourhood. Some thought the site was the conservation area, possibly due to the lack of signage, more likely the extension impact of the greenery along high traditional sandstone wall in the secret garden atmosphere. Bromborough Village Conservation Area is comparatively small, hiding behind more houses but not promoting its virtues to local residents or casual visitors.
You have 1 minute left.
The only looking glass. site visit was the heights of the ground above Mark Rake to in relation to the road. It's actually 5'4". Okay? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Would the applicant or agent like to speak on this? Again, if you state your name and contact by name.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Nigel Fultz. I'm a planning consultant and I'm representing both Hope, the applicant, and the Diocese of Chester, the landowner. Your officer report is very clear, but I would like to highlight a few key issues. The first one, why develop the land? The diocese decided that the land, which is just under an acre, was too large for the garden of the rectory, and deemed the land surplus to requirements. It was then decided that the monies from the sale would allow the rectory to be renovated, which has happened, and fund improvement works elsewhere. So in support of the scheme, I would comment as follows. The principle of the development. The scheme lies within the settlement boundary of Bromborough and within the primary residential area. And so this small-scale residential development is acceptable in principle and meets your policy HS4. As noted on the site visit, this is not a designated urban green space or other area of important open space. The scheme is supported by National Planning Policy Framework, which promotes sustainable development and reducing the need to travel. There could be few sites as sustainable as this one. A couple of minutes walk from the retail centre of Bromborough and 100 metres from the employment area to the east of the A41. So in principle, this is a highly sustainable location and in line with National Planning Policy Framework. The proposed houses are smaller three-bed semi-detached houses in order to provide homes for local people. We're providing two affordable units, which is fully in line with your planning policy. Importantly, the site lies outside the Bromborough Conservation Area. The rear boundary of the site is the northern extremity of the conservation area, but it's formed with a stone wall and a thick vegetation and tree screen, meaning that the site has very little impact upon the conservation area. As the officers mentioned, the scheme meets the requirements of your policy CH20. The houses have been designed as traditional cottage-style properties, which are shown here, constructed of brick with a clay tile roof, and include chimneys, porches, and traditional window designs. There are listed buildings in the wider area, but as explained in the officer report, none are affected by the development. In terms of access, this is taken directly off Mark Rake, and your highways officers support the scheme. The access would create a hole in the existing boundary wall, and that stone would be reused to create flank walls running into the site along each side of the driveway. Parking is only contained on site and three spaces per dwelling are provided in line with your parking policy. We've spoken to the immediate neighbour to the western boundary. She's keen to see the removal of the self-seeded trees along her garden boundary, which will allow more light into her garden. The existing houses on the opposite side of Mark Rake face towards the site, but are 26 metres from the gables of the properties closest to them, plots 1 and 10, which face onto Mark Rake. And the nearest habitable room windows, which face onto those existing properties, are plots 5 and 6, and they are over 50 metres away. The rectory is also just over 21 metres from the nearest plot, too. So these relationships far exceed your interface separation distances. We've also provided a wide range of reports to demonstrate that the site is capable of development, and these include an archaeological report, which has been prepared by the Field Archaeology Unit of National Museums Liverpool, and your officers have suggested an archaeological condition. The ecological and further back survey was prepared by ETIV Ecology. These concluded that subject to mitigation, the scheme does not impact upon any protected species, and your own ecologist supports the scheme. A tree report was undertaken by the Urban Forestry Group. The trees which are being removed are largely self-set, including conifers and sycamores, along with garden shrubs and hedges.
You have 1 minute left.
Thank you. The key mature trees around the edge of the site, including those along the churchyard boundary, along with those adjacent to the rectory, including the sweet chestnut and the beech tree, are to be retained. We're also proposing to replant 10 trees and 45 metres length of hawthorn hedging. and again your tree officer supports a scheme. So in conclusion, this is a highly sustainable project in line with national planning policy guidance. The details are acceptable in terms of planning policy, and your statutory consulting to raise an objection. And on this basis, I hope you're able to approve the scheme this evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there one council would like to speak on this? Councillor Pat Cleary. You would just state your name for the...
Yeah, Councillor Stephen of Lib Dem, Brighton. A couple of points that I'd like to cover from the obviously residents' point of view and to counter something that the applicant has made. The issue of the levels between the site road and Mark Rake itself on the site visit was said to be 3 foot. Kevin obviously alluded what he had measured and that. The issue I have, given the nature of the area, there will be a site road, and we've heard from the applicant there will be 3 car spaces per property. Which
Two.
Which equates to 20 cars. Members who attended the site visit will be aware when the sandstone wall was inspected, that there was a blue car parked opposite what is proposed to be the entrance to the site, and therefore I hope those members will be very clear about the narrowness of Mark Road if a car is parked opposite at one of the other properties on Mark Road. As has been said, it's not designated, but it is a local wildlife area. Sight lines can be achieved, as was indicated by our officers on the site visit, but members need to be aware that Mark Rake is actually a feeder road for the larger Brightmore estate to the rear, which has a number of properties, just under 1,000, and is one of the feeder roads that is used. I understand from the site visit, our officers indicated that there had to be a rejig of the application because the separation levels were not achieved. Given the issues with regard to water, and you've heard that already tonight about another site, I would be very concerned with regard to runoff from the site, given the levels of what is proposed as a gradient, and whether that gradient would be supported with regard to this application, I do not know, because I'm not technically qualified to say that. But it does concern me that issues of drainage onto Mark Rake might be cause serious problems in the future. And if a resident wishes to park their car opposite the entrance to this site, they are quite entitled to do so because there's no parking restrictions. So how people are going to access the Brightmore estate via Mark Rake, and those residents, if approved, who live there with 20 cars, get out of this site, I do not know. I therefore request you refuse the application.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Can I
look to the committee? Any comment? Dave? Thank you, Chair. Site visit was very informative. Those members that were there will remember that I've been asked about the topography of the particular site in relation to the road, which we, the agent at the time, said it's about 3 foot. Obviously, those that were on site and then went out onto the road realised there's a slightly bigger difference in the levels inside the site and outside the site. I also asked the question in relation to sight lines, given the entrance and exit to the proposed development. It's on the inside of the curvature of a bend. I think the board councillor highlighted the narrowness of the road with the comments about the blue car that was there on the day. I found it very hard to look at this and think of any reason I would need to refuse. There's two things that do stick out to me more than anything else, and that is the age of the site itself, what was there before. We know it's covered with the archaeological coverage in the conditions, and the same with the trees. But when you think about the amount of topsoil that's going to be removed to get the levels and the elevations, it could be an awful long time before this site's actually developed and defined any archaeological artifacts. And I believe much more building because everybody knows the history of that particular part from the history of it itself. I've got no argument with that. The other point is, if you do want to the changes in levels, all those trees that need to be retained, I know it does give a good description of the heights of covering the certain distance of the foot and the canopy of the trees. Wouldn't they end up with lumps on the side where the trees are going to be retained? Just 2 points I'd like to make.
Thank you, Through You Chair. Just to pick up on that issue, there are conditions that are outlined in the report that deal with the protection of trees. So any material that brought into the site or taken away from the site would have to accord with those conditions so the trees would be protected, including their root structure.
Anybody else want to make any comments?
Chair? Thank you, Chair. Yeah, I do have issues with this, and as Councillor Boult already stated, about the traffic issues. It is quite narrow coming down Mark Rake, you know, we have issues there. It says here the proposal does not result in a detrimental change of characters in the area. I think it certainly does. I mean, I know it's not in the conservation area there, but it's right on the boundary, isn't it? I think it would be. Having said that, I found, can't find grants for these users, to be honest. So unfortunately, I won't be supporting, but unfortunately, I can't find grants.
In terms of the conservation area, it's probably worth noting that the scheme was drawn up in close consultation with our conservation officers and colleagues at MIAS in terms of the archaeological impact of the site. So we have had very careful consideration both to the conservation aspects of the scheme and also the archaeological interest as well. So we have taken that on board, but we do feel it's appropriate in this instance.
Okay, so there's no other comments. The officer's recommendation is to move this subject to the conditions listed. Do you have a mover? Thank you, Steve. And second day. All those in favour of approval? Against? Okay, that's carried. We now move to agenda item 6, which is on page 39. I think you have a presentation, please.
Thank you, through you, Chair. Planning permission is sought for the creation of one 5-metre-wide access onto Cllr Road. The application has been amended since it was first submitted, originally seeking consent for 2 accesses, each 9 metres wide. The amendments were sought as 2 accesses so wide were considered to be harmful to the greenbelt, particularly having regard to the level of activity taking place in the field behind, which is currently small-scale and limited in nature. The land to which access will be gained is being used as a developing organic fruit and vegetable farm, although at present activities are small scale due to the land largely being worked by hand. A small number of fruit trees are currently present, but the access will allow some further development for agricultural purposes, allowing agricultural vehicles to access the land for cultivation. The proposals have been significantly reduced in scale and are considered to be acceptable in terms of any impact on the greenbelt, allowing the developing organic fruit and vegetable farm to grow and in doing so contribute to supporting the rural environment and economy. The proposals as amended are considered to be acceptable, resulting in minimal harm to the greenbelt or the character of the area, and are recommended for approval. There is a qualified petition for objection.
Would the petitioner like to speak on this? No? So is the ward councillor like to speak on it? I think you're well aware, so could you say
been told, this application has been amended. It was originally for two very wide new entrances onto Cllr Road. I should put it in context. If you come into West Caldy, Caldy from the Thurston Cutting, you come to the Caldy roundabout and then you come round a rather nice wide sweeping area of road between two areas of greenbelt with a very nice belt of trees on your left hand side. And this was protected by tree preservation order going back to the Wallasey Urban District Council, so it's from 1974. It is a very, very much loved scene, this, very much prized, and adds considerably to the character of my ward. So therefore, any suggestion that it might be harmed in any way obviously brought out a lot of objections. When I first saw this application, I really thought, what is going on here? How many combine harvesters a day were expected to bring out onto this road through these very wide entrances? So I'm very pleased to see it has been reduced to one much narrower entrance. There are a long list of conditions at the back of your report, an awful lot about the trees, and I really do hope that they will be strictly adhered to. And the other little concern I have about that is that the plans which have been submitted, appearing on the website, are, shall we say, slightly informal. Going to the site today, I did take a little bit of time to understand exactly where I was, but I did work it out in the end. I'm sure the applicant who is here tonight does have the best intentions in this respect, but I do regard this matter as a really serious matter, which really needs to be taken very, very carefully. It is very important for me, but it is very important for the trees. There is just one other item towards the lower end of page 41 on your report. A number of objections have stated that the creation of such large accesses onto this land is a means to make the site more developable, and it says for residential purposes, but I would have thought for any other purposes as well. When we saw the two very wide entrances, it rather looked like it was going to be a very big reset operation. How many cars a day in both directions was required? Obviously not now, narrow entrance, but you could well understand why residents were a little bit worried about this. I hope that the planning committee will bear that in mind, and if they feel it poses any other conditions they might need. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Jeffrey. Obviously, if there was to be a further development on the line, then it would be subject to that. Okay, can I have the committee, please, Dave?
Thank you, Chair. Councillor Wong and I share responsibility for this particular ward. It's a beautiful area, very nice area. The original intention of putting 2 9-metre long access points onto it, in my view, was totally unacceptable. I'm glad to see that it's now been reduced to something far more manageable. Let us remember also this is a piece of green belt, so in order to turn that into a housing development, if that ever was to happen, it would be quite a challenge and quite a trauma to go through. So I don't think we've got an awful lot of fear of that, so I would ask the Caldy people who are concerned about that to have their fears allayed, because their ward councillors will go out of the way to make sure that nothing nasty happens in the area. So having said that, this is now an acceptable proposal.
Yeah.
It will help to create a fruit farm or whatever in that area, which would go down very well. So I have no hesitation in recommending it for approval, and I'd like to move that unless anybody else has
any. I'll second it, Chair. Right, through. We have a mover and a second. All those in favour of approval, subject to the conditions listed.
Thank you.
That's unanimous. That's carried. Thank you. Okay. Agenda item 7 and 8 are subject to site visits, and 9 have declared an interest in this. So we move to agenda item 9, pages 57 to 62, please, and I think we have a presentation.
Yeah, thank you, Deputy Chair. Commissioners sought the erection of a new dwelling in the garden of 23 Abbey Road. The dwelling would be located adjacent to number 23, set back from Abbey Road. The site is located on a corner plot situated on a 90-degree bend in Abbey Road, which results in the site being read as having two street scenes with building lines to the north and east. The new dwelling is located on the site in such a way that it follows the building lines to the north of the site, sitting with the front elevation of 23 Abbey Road, and similarly follows the building line to the east, sitting in line with 25 Abbey Road. Access to the site is located away from the bend in the road adjacent to 25 Abbey Road. Due to a difference in land levels, the proposed new building will sit lower than 23 Abbey Road. House types and street scene are all varied with different scales, different styles and character, and the street scene is predominantly two-storey in nature. Therefore, the two-storey dwelling proposed will not read as out of character in its immediate setting. There are windows on the side elevation of 25 Abbey Road, the property immediately to the east. The new dwelling proposed has been designed to minimise any platform adjacent to dwelling. Obscure glazing will be used on windows at first floor, which falls short of the 21 metres normally expected. This is acceptable as other windows would provide outlook for the new bedrooms without resulting in the loss of privacy to the neighbouring house. Windows on the south-facing side elevation of 23 Abbey Road for host dwelling are either secondary windows with the principal window unaffected or relate to non-habitable rooms. In any case, the owner of this property is the applicant and is therefore aware of any potential impact on that property, which in any case has been deemed to be acceptable. Off-street parking is provided and the proposed new vehicular access would be located some 40 metres away from the bend in Abbey Road. Given that vehicles would be travelling slowly at this point in the road to navigate the sharp bend, and given the distance separating the access from the bend, there are not considered to be any adverse highway impacts resulting from this development. The proposals are considered to be acceptable and are recommended for approval. There is a qualified petition for objection.
I assume you are the petitioner.
Yes. I think I'm a little deaf.
Okay. Well, you're very well prepared. So if we can ask you to turn on your microphone.
Which button?
So silver.
Green.
It's a new microphone.
Green.
Okay. Could I ask you to state your name and your address, and you have up to 5 minutes to speak.
Yes.
I'll indicate when you have a minute left.
Thank you. My name's Trevor England. I live at number 27 Abbey Road. The Council's 2020 plan has a lot to say about communities. Well, the community that's Abbey Road raised this petition objecting to the proposal with 47 signatures. There would have been more, but there aren't any more people. Most of my comments will follow progressively through the report that your office has provided. On traffic implications, which have just been talked about, I hope that the very serious accident that took place on that corner was taken into account when the traffic people decided it was all right to make another gateway there. If not, I would just like to remind you that is the case. Now, in the report, the proposed property says it's two stories, but it's actually three. There's a bedroom in the roof. And that increases particularly the overlooking of the other properties around the property. And even at ground floor level, when the trees and the hedges are cut, it will be seen, and they surely will be, because they are tremendously overgrown at the moment and take up a large part of the garden. The property will not be visible principally from the south. It's in front of the building line, contrary to what your officer said. It is in front of the building line, and if you look at the plans which you may have in front of you, you will discover if you draw a line down Abbey Road, approximately one third of the building will be in front of the building line, and that's a considerable amount. I also remember that when number 29 was built, he wanted to put his house 1 metre forward of the building line, and that was refused. Regarding separation distances between the new proposal and number 25, concentrates on what is acceptable, but because one window on the gable, on the side of number 25, is more than 21 metres away, but the rest are very much within it and are severely affected, and there's not enough emphasis placed on that in the officer's report. One SOP seems to be that a large picture window in a bedroom will be obscure. It doesn't say how obscure. Some obscure glass is very seeable. And I'm sure that it will be rather farcical to have a window that's glazed, clear glazed on one side and obscure on the other. And I'm no doubt that shortly after it's all been settled, the obscure glass will get removed, and who's going to take action to see that that's enforced? Now, the distances between number 23 and the proposed house seem from the plan to be no more than 5 metres. And there are four large windows in the gable of 23. And from my knowledge, four of them, now there are five windows altogether, four of them are habitable. Just because the applicant lives there should not be a reason for the easement, if you like, of the rules. Finally, I wish to bring to your notice application OUT/14-00546, which was 1 Rock Avenue, Heslop, almost identical in its form in terms of separation distance. And that was declined as satisfactory demonstration had resulted in significant levels of enclosure and poor outlook from the existing house, contrary to policy HS4. The separation distances appear the same in this case, and the applicant is also a resident in the house. In conclusion, we feel that the proposal breaches your own rules in so many ways, and we would ask you to decline the application. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Would the applicant or agent like to speak on this?
My name is Stephen Bryan, I'm from BROMBOROUGH Architects, the agent for this submitted scheme. We developed the scheme for the house very closely in conjunction with the planning department, from very early pre-application advice through to the submitted scheme. Initially, we developed lots of different potential sites as to where the dwelling could be situated. There was an agreement with the planners as to where it sort of been situated, where it is, to respect those building lines. Or provide the space for the dwelling. Abbey Road is a site of over 2,000 square metres. The actual plot that we are dividing off is about 885 square metres. So in terms of the size of it, it's a very big plot for the building. The actual site was also chosen because it's a metre, naturally it's a metre lower than the existing ground floor level of the property. So being a two-storey dwelling with a room in the roof, it is naturally set and subservient to the existing property that's on the site. In terms of the third floor, the room in the roof, that is just an additional sort of bedroom which is lit by enveloped windows rather than sort of balcony or anything at that level. So, and it's actually on the south west elevation, so the interface from that outlook to any property is 50-60 metres. It's looking down the site into the road. In terms of appearance of the dwelling, we've looked closely at all the different types of properties on Abbey Road, and because of the different ages of properties, there is a big mix of properties from brick and white, render with brick detailing. So the appearance of the house, we try to sort of keep it in line with what is there. I suppose one of the objections was about the interface distances. So what is how you measure that interface distance? We are borderline sort of 20, 21 metres to one bedroom window, and the way we've dealt with it is to provide a sort of bay on that element so that the windows that are sort of directly interfacing could be frosted in a glass to be agreed with the planners, and we've left the side ones open so that there can be a view from those bedrooms, but actually there is no direct loss of privacy due to those windows. There's plenty, like I said, we provide off-street parking. We've located the entrance to the site just adjacent to the current entrance to the site, so it is well away from the bend where there's concerns about sort of traffic. But for one additional dwelling, as the highways are pointed out, there isn't enough concerns to warrant refusal on highways grounds for the application. We think that we've designed, you know, an appropriate house for the dwelling in appropriate space with respect to sort of interface different distances and building lines. And obviously the scheme has been recommended for approval by the officer, and we hope that you sort of support it and move forward and recommend for approval as well.
Thank you for keeping me in mind. Is there a ward council would like to speak on this? Jeffrey. Just in case we've forgotten the name.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Once again, Councillor Jeffrey Ross, West Gerby, Thurston Ward. So that was the last time I read that as well. As you've heard, there's a petition objection of 47 signatures and there are 12 individual objections. The main issue seems to me to be the building line and the separation distances under HS4. You told there are two distinct building lines as it's in a corner plot. Put it in context, as you can probably see from the plan on the screen, number 23 was once one, I understand, was literally one big house, and it subsequently was divided in this rather strange manner, and has very large sort of front and side garden, and that's where the discussion had been taken as to where to put this proposed new dwelling. I tend to agree it's probably the right place to put it, but it's the distances which are the problem, and looking at the planning which went on the website, it does appear to me to actually exceed both building lines. So that's the first point. The second point is its proximity to house number 25, which is effectively going to be to its rear. Excuses made that although it's within the prescribed distance under HS4, you can get away with it by obscurely glazing the window. It's also said that because it's close to the original house number 23, that doesn't matter because most of the rooms aren't important, and anyway, the applicant lives there and they don't mind. Well, my experience in these things is that the applicants tend